Well, hi again, Tracy. Tonight we're going to talk about testing for IBS and some of the other conditions that you treat. You're a clinical nutritionist, so can you describe to us what kind of testing you will be using for a patient that will come to see you?
Yes, I can certainly give you an idea. I mean, I tend to use the patient's answers to a health questionnaire in order to be able to narrow down areas that I think need a deeper investigation and where testing might be helpful. But typically with irritable bowel syndrome, probably I'm going to use a couple of the following three tests, maybe four tests. So the first test that I would be suggesting is probably a breath test, a hydrogen breath test for SIBO, small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. Now what that involves is that the person will drink a lactulose solution, which is a special type of non-digestible sugar, well, non-digestible by human beings. And basically, they will then give a breath sample every 20 minutes for 3 hours. Now, if you have bacteria overgrowing in your small intestine, they will metabolise the lactulose and they will produce gases, hydrogen and methane, which is then picked up by the breath test machine. And then the lab will send me a report with the gas levels at each 20 minutes so that I can see the gas production in the upper gut. So that's probably the first test.
Is that test done at home?
It can be done at home or in lab. So, I mean, it's quite a dull test to do. Mm-hmm. So it is one that you could do very easily at home. You know, sit at home with an egg timer and do a breath sample every 20 minutes. It's very straightforward. And you effectively will just be blowing a load of bubbles, you know, and mm-hmm. then boxing them up and sending them off to the laboratory for them to run it through the breath test machine.
Okay.
The second test is the organic acid profile. Now, the reason that I do this is because the hydrogen breath test for SIBO can be fallible on occasions. There are a population of people where the test will be negative even though the person might still have SIBO. Or the person might have a mixed bacterial or yeast picture in their upper gut, in which case the organic acid test is able to show me levels of yeast that's overgrowing there, which is not picked up by the breath test. And that's even simpler. That's actually just a first morning urine sample. So very straightforward. Again, you just would package up your wee and send it off to the lab and they will do the diagnostics on that.
Okay, great. And the third type you mentioned?
The third type, as you probably would have realised by now, is going to be a stool test.
I was worried you were going to say that.
Yeah, I mean, that would be your most favourite thing to do. It shouldn't be anyway. But it does give an incredible amount of information about the microflora of your gut. And what it involves is a number of stool samples over 3 days. So it will be three samples on three consecutive mornings or three consecutive days collected, and then it will be posting them off to the lab again.
So you collect them yourself at home, comfort, safety of your own home,
absolutely.
And post them all at once after the 3 days?
Yes, absolutely. You'll hang on to them. Stool samples are actually very, very stable. So they're fine hanging about for a day or two. And all of the vials that you'll use to collect your samples in contain a preservative, which will make sure that your sample is still in the right condition for when the lab receive it.
Okay, and is there any that are more comprehensive, or is it a collection of all three?
Yeah, the organic acid profile and the stool test are available in the basic format and also a comprehensive. And as the name suggests, the basic gives us the bare bones of the information, which will be what microbes you've got, what levels of beneficial flora you've got, and levels of yeast or bacteria or parasites with the stool test.
Okay, so when you're working with your patients, do you recommend all of them, none of them, two of them? You know, just give us a bit of a feel about how it works.
It's highly personalised, and it really is dependent on their answers to the health questionnaire, and then I will always ask them a lot of questions because I will double check information, make sure that someone's understood what I've meant by, you know, some of the questions, and I will always read the questionnaire back or my thoughts back to the patient so that the patient can say, yes, that's right, or no, actually, that isn't what I meant to convey, it's this, it's that. And then I will say, you know, listen, I think that we need to do some testing on the upper gut because, you know, you're bloating so quickly after eating that I don't think that can be your large bowel. I think the problem is lying higher up, either with your stomach or your small intestine. But I always try and bear in mind the patient's pocket, you know, how much money someone has. And, you know, these tests are wonderful, the amount of information they can give us, but they are not free. And I always try and bear that in mind in the recommendations that I make.
Okay, I guess also that you test at the beginning, the ultimate is to test at the end, or are generally people feeling so much better that there's no need to test to just put it right?
It really depends on the individual. Some people just say, I feel great, or even, you know, I've got to a point with the diet and, you know, we might have used some antimicrobial supplements, and they might say, look, this is livable, I'm good, you know, thanks very much, and I'm off. My preference is always to test for progress, test not guess. And the reason being is that I've just learned the hard way that symptoms are not reliable in many people at helping me to gauge progress. And of course the problem is, if you only can beat back the bacteria or clear the parasites to a point, and then the person goes back to a normal diet and lifestyle, then the problem could just return in a couple of months, which is absolutely demoralising. So it makes perfect sense, I think, just to make sure that the job is done.
But what I think I hear you saying is a really consultative approach on what the patient feels comfortable with, what you think's right for them, and there's no set format. It's really about the one-to-one relationship you have with your patient.
Yeah, I'm on the same side as the patient. We work in collaboration, we're a team. That's really important. And I will always explain myself fully at my thought process, why I'm making a suggestion. I'll always make sure that the person understands where I'm coming from. I hope that they, you know, they agree. Or if something's not clear, then I'll explain it, you know, as many times as it takes for them to be able to understand what's going on, because I think that's very important.
Okay, thank you for explaining testing, and we look forward to speaking to you again soon.